As a developer, I quickly got into the habit of pushing to GitHub multiple times a day. So it surprises me when I hear that operations teams are tackling their infrastructure automation with a lot of manual processes. Hey everyone, my name is Sai Vennam, and today I want to talk about Ansible. Ansible is an open source infrastructure automation tool initially developed by Red Hat and enables you to tackle kind of all of the major challenges that come with infrastructure and enables you to do so with code. Or in other terms, infrastructure as code. Now, Ansible has three major kind of uses, and I'll start with the first one because this is generally the one that people tend to gravitate to when they hear infrastructure automation, and that's the provisioning use case. So the first step of kind of any infrastructure story, you gotta have some infrastructure in the first place. So let's say that using Ansible, we've already spun up some environment. Let's say it's a VPC, and my favorite cloud provider. And within this VPC, I've got three virtual machines. So we'll say we've got one, two, and then a third one as well. Now, these set of virtual machines are gonna essentially be our set of hosts. In the Ansible world, we're gonna call this an inventory. So it's basically the set of hosts that Ansible can work against. So what we're gonna call this is an inventory. Now, within this inventory, we can actually create even more subcategorizations. And Ansible calls this patterns. So let's say these virtual machines have different, you know, underlying tasks and use cases and services that they're going to be running. So these first two virtual machines, we'll call them web, because they're going to be used for web servers. And then this last one, we're gonna call this DB because we're gonna run MySQL database on it. So there we go. We've got our infrastructure. We've got that provision kind of step already done. And I wanna jump to the second thing that Ansible is really good at. It's config management. And actually, I'd say this is kind of the main use case that most people think about when they first start to use Ansible. And this kind of refers to the ability to configure your actual infrastructure. So a simple example would be something like operating system patches, or maybe making sure a certain service is running, maybe installing some service onto a virtual machine. So in our use case today, let's focus on that. Let's focus on how we can do config management with these virtual machines. Now, one of the key tenets of Ansible is that it's declarative. Now, out there, there's kind of the notion that Ansible can be both declarative as well as procedural or imperative. And the idea is that with Ansible, you declare what you want instead of focusing on how it gets there. But in essence, it can also be considered procedural because the underlying tasks that run are procedural in nature. But as a user of Ansible, you're taking advantage of the declarative aspect of it, meaning you define what you want rather than how to get to whatever it is that you need. Now, today, what we want is to be able to run some tasks against those VMs. Let's say we want to run some OS patches and then install a programming language and then install MySQL. So what we'll need is a playbook. So that's what we'll start with first. We'll create an Ansible playbook. And as the name indicates, a playbook is going to be a book of tasks or a set of plays, rather. Now, our first play, we want to run this against all of our hosts, and we want to just run a security patch. We want to make sure they're all running the same version of the same operating system. So that will be our first play. So a play is going to be kind of consisting of three main things. You need a name for that play, you need the host that it's going to run against, and you need the actual tasks that it'll run. Now, in this particular play, let's say that we've got the hosts set to all, because we want to run this against all the hosts. And as far as the tasks, we'll define some set of tasks like security patching and that kind of thing. Now, key thing that I want to mention here, Ansible takes advantage of YAML to do its kind of declarative nature of being able to declare what you want. So this is obviously not valid YAML, but in the real world, you know, when working with Ansible, this would be in YAML format. So that'll be our first play running against all of the hosts in our inventory. Now let's create some more plays here. Let's create a play that runs directly against the hosts for our web servers. So we call that web, right? And this is going to have a set of tasks. Maybe we need to do something like install Go and install Python, maybe install some other services that are specific to our web servers. And finally, we'll create one more play in this playbook. And for this one, we'll set the host to be our DB. And then for instead of tasks, let's talk about something called roles. Ansible has a concept of roles, which basically enable you to group together actions that you run multiple times. So instead of having to define all of the tasks every single time, you can just define the roles. And that will take advantage of, you know, the underlying modules and tasks that need to be run. By the way, a playbook is one way of grouping together a set of tasks that you need to run. It's a declarative way of doing it. But if you really want to keep things procedural and imperative, you can actually run one-off tasks by themselves and do so in an imperative way or a procedural way. But this is kind of the way you would do a fully declarative approach to automate a set of tasks against, you know, the set of hosts in your inventory. So this is our playbook, and we want to execute this now. That's going to bring me to my second tenet of Ansible, and that's the fact that it's agentless. Now, Ansible is agentless in the sense that, like a lot of other infrastructure automation tools, unlike a lot of other infrastructure automation tools, you don't actually need to install an agent on the VMs that were provisioned. So Ansible is able to take advantage of SSH to actually directly go into those VMs and run the tasks that it needs to. So let's see what that looks like, right? So we take our playbook, and as a user, we'll execute Ansible. And Ansible can execute, you know, in most Unix-like environments. So we'll execute our playbook, and it'll run against our virtual machines. And there we go. We're happy. But here's one thing to think about. Now, chances are we wouldn't be running Ansible on our local machine, right? At the end of the day, it has to store SSH keys and a lot of kind of other secure configuration, and you're not really trying to run automation off your local machine. So there's a capability out there called AWX, or Ansible Tower, which is the downstream project of the open source AWX. And that's basically a graphical interface and set of APIs that enable you to run Ansible and operationalize it across your organization. So whether you're using Ansible or Ansible Tower, a user will come in, execute that playbook, and there we go. We'll have our config management executed. Now, the third aspect that I want to talk about with Ansible is the fact that it's idempotent. Now, what exactly does that mean? So idempotent refers to an operation that can be run multiple times without changing beyond the initial application. In other terms, the first time I run this operation, it should recognize that the security patches need to be installed, the services need to be installed, the Python and Go and MySQL or whatever needs to be installed has to be done. The second time I execute that same playbook, it's going to recognize it's already done it, and it's going to say, hey, nothing needs to be done. But let's say I come back my second day, and I say, oh, we need to actually update the operating system version from, you know, 1.0 to 1.1, and we run this same playbook in Ansible or Ansible Tower, and it recognizes it and says, hey, that operating system patch changed, but nothing else did. It's going to execute the only action it needs to kind of resolve that difference. Now, one thing to consider, all of these tasks have underlying modules that power them, and you want to make sure that the modules themselves are programmed in a way that's idempotent. And this is important, and it kind of brings me to my last point here, is that Ansible is community-driven. That means that if I'm trying to do these things in a playbook that I kind of outlined today, chances are someone out there has already developed the playbooks, the modules, the tasks that I need to actually do those operations. Those are basically published as collections in what's called Ansible Galaxy, which is a repository where developers can kind of contribute their Ansible kind of modules or playbooks or tasks, whatever they might have created in the ecosystem. That's one of the great things about Ansible is that it's so community-driven that chances are whatever I'll need to do, I'll be able to find in that Galaxy, Ansible Galaxy. The one kind of disclaimer I'll say, make sure, run these operations locally, make sure they're idempotent, make sure that executing them multiple times responds in a way that's kind of predictable. So all that being said, we've kind of talked about how Ansible is a declarative language. It doesn't require an agent to be able to execute in these kind of end environments in these virtual machines. It's idempotent based on the modules that you're using to enable you to avoid things like config drift by making sure that any changes that you make should be done in your infrastructure automation story, whether it's playbooks or roles or modules. And then finally, you know, you can rest easy knowing that chances are whatever you need to automate is available in the community. Now, the third use case, I mentioned there are three things that you can do with Ansible, is going to be app deployment. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail here today about the app deployment use case, but the fact is you can use Ansible to then take it a step further and deploy your actual web applications and workloads into the virtual machines. It's also a capability available by Ansible. I hope this was helpful. If you liked this video or have any comments, be sure to drop a like or a comment below. Stay tuned and follow us for more videos like this in the future. Thank you.